The perceptron is a basic computational unit that transforms the d-dimensional input it receives into an output, and it does it in a simple way. And I'd like to discuss in this video the type of computation that the perceptron does. So let's assume that we are dealing with d-dimensional data presented to us in the form of a vector with d components, each one of these components being a real number. Each component of this input can be seen as an entry neuron into the perceptron, and I'm using this terminology of neurons just to build on this intuition that perceptrons are taking their inspiration from the architecture of the brain. So each component of this input, we will see it as an entry neuron into the perceptron. And the perceptron is going to compute something, some value, based on the combined values of the inputs it receives. The input neurons are linked to this output neuron, that is the perceptron, with directed edges, and each one is going to be labeled with a so-called synaptic weight. And you can see this visually in the following way. If I'm showing this output neuron, and I'm just writing here y, this is going to be the computation done by the perceptron, or if you like, by the output neuron of the perceptron. So this perceptron is going to have these inputs x1, x2, and so on, xd, and each one of these I'm going to show as its own input neuron. And as I said, these input neurons, they are linked with some directed edges to this output neuron, and each one of them is coming with a synaptic weight, and I'm going to denote the weight of this edge with W, and the weight of this edge with W2, and so on, WD. And all of these W's, the weights, are real numbers. So I'm writing here WJ. They are real numbers for all these J's from 1 to D. And what the output neuron does, or what the perceptron does, is essentially a linear computation in terms of the inputs. So the computation that it does is of this type, is going to be W1 x1 plus W2 x2 plus all the way WD xd. And as usual, there is also a free term, so it's going to be W0 plus all of these terms. So the perceptron essentially does this kind of computation. Now, to simplify this notation and to write it in a vectorial form, something that's going to ease out our considerations when we consider a little bit more complex architecture with several perceptrons and maybe perceptrons feeding into some other perceptrons. I'm going to write this in this way. It's going to be in a vectorial notation. First, I'm writing this as a sum, but I'm showing that this W can also be considered as a weight times an input that's always 1. If we think in this way, this is the same thing as saying that we will add an input neuron that I'm going to denote with x0. So this is also W0 times x0 plus W1 x1 and so on, W2 dxd. Now, this x0 is always going to be equal to 1 by convention. It's not really part of our data set, but I'm going to consider that I have one extra dimension, then that's always equal to 1. And it fits into the output neuron with a weight that's equal to W0. And again, I'm just doing this so that I can essentially write this vectorial notation. So the computation of the neuron being equal to W transpose times X, where W is simply the vector of these weights, W0, W1, WD. And as usually, I'm writing vectors in a column notation. And X this time is going to include our x0 component. So I'm abusing a little bit in the notation here. I started with x being a d-dimensional vector, and now I'm denoting with the same letter x this d plus one dimensional vector, and I'm hoping that this will not lead to any confusions. So once again, the perceptron does a linear computation. A linear computation in terms of the input it receives, and to ease out our notations, I'm going to show this as being a d plus 1 vectorial computation, where the first component is essentially added to our data set, and it's always equal to 1. To give more details about the computation of a perceptron, I want to comment that a perceptron can be used both for a regression problem as well as for a classification problem. And in the case of a regression problem, the output neuron simply does the linear computation I wrote on the previous slide. So the computation is going to be simply this output is going to be W transpose times X. And remember, X is this d plus 1 dimensional vector. I'm showing here the additional component always equal to 1. And even though I'm showing here just one neuron, you should understand that this is really the d-dimensional input. So if you like, this stands for all these d-input neurons consisting of the original data dimensions. And this being a linear model, this is the usual linear regression problem where essentially you are fitting a hyperplane. In this visualization, I'm just showing the data as being one-dimensional, but in general, this is going to be a hyperplane in our d-dimensional space. In the case of a classification problem, the output neuron does a little bit of an additional calculation in addition to this linear computation W transpose times X. Is going to classify the data as being in class 0 or in class 1, depending on whether this linear calculation gives you a positive or a negative result. So in other words, the classification procedure is based on whether the W transpose times X is larger than 0 or not. So if you want to see this visually, this is the same as before. We have our always one input neuron, and we have the other input neurons collecting all the data components, and they fit to this output neuron. And in fact, this output neuron, you can obviously see it as I wrote it here in terms of this one function, whether this linear computation is larger than zero or not. But remember also, we had in a previous lecture that we can also think about this as being a computation through the sigmoid function. So you can also see this as the sigmoid function applied to W transpose times X, which is 1 over exponential of minus W transpose times X. So that's going to give a probability distribution between the two classes that you aim to classify from. So I'm showing this idea with this sigmoid function, the sigma applied to this output neuron. And visually speaking, you can see this both as a linear discriminator, so this blue line here separating the two classes, but you can also see it in terms of the probability distribution described with the help of this sigmoid function, just like we had in a previous lecture. We can also have an architecture where we have, in fact, k parallel perceptrons, and this is building up towards these slightly more complex architectures where we have two layers of perceptrons feeding into each other. So I want to discuss about this case where we have perceptrons processing in parallel the same kind of input. So you can see this as having k output neurons, and they are all connected to the same input component. So in the input neurons, we have, just like before, we have our original data x1, x2, all the way to xd, and we have also this input neuron x0 that's always equal to plus 1. And we have these synapses connecting the input neurons with the output neurons y1, y2, yk. So this means that we have now a weight matrix Describing all of these synaptic connections. So the weight matrix is going to be denoted by capital W, and this is going to be of dimensions k, so as many rows as we have output neurons times d plus 1, as many columns as we have input neurons. So we will have one row for each output neuron and one column for each input neuron. And in the case of a regression problem, what this ith output neuron yi is going to do is going to be just like before, is going to be a linear combination of the inputs. So it's going to be a sum by j from 0 to d by wij times xj. And this I can write as being wi transposed times times x, and I is the ith column of this matrix W. And so if we combine these all things together, then we get that the output of these k parallel perceptrons, if I'm writing it as a vector, this is going to be exactly equal to the weight matrix W times x. If we deal with a classification problem, then we are going to calculate the these linear outputs first, and then there will be an additional processing of these outputs. But the linear output is going to be just like before. It's going to be just transpose times x, where wi is the ith column of our matrix W. And the outputs that we calculate, remember, this is a classification problem, and we have to distinguish between k classes. And we have had this before. We are going to use the softmax function. So what this means is that we are going to have the exponential applied to this output oi over the sum of all these. So if I'm writing maybe with j, is going to be a little bit easier to see. So from with j from 1 to capital K, exponential of the output oj. And this is, again, I'm writing here, this is the idea of the softmax function. And in terms of the decision or classification decision, we are just going to compare these yi's, and we are going to choose, so we will say choose as the class, we are going to choose I to be the argument that gives us this maximum maximum yk. So it's going to be with maximum, I'm going to write it like this, yj, and that's going to pick up the maximum from 1 to k.